The palms really are a sign of the one we worship and follow and dedicate our lives to. And so you take that dedication in your heart to the King. We honor him for the person who's not here today. So we enter into Holy Week, a very special week. I'll say more about that. I want to make Holy Week not just another week, but this week holy. And so let's take that moment quiet. We'll begin with the proclamation of Jesus, triumphal entry into Jerusalem.
We begin with prayer. We do. We gather together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so we bless these palm branches that you hold. Lord, may our faith be real. And listen, Lord, thank you for listening to our prayers. Today we honor Christ, our triumphant King. We do so by carrying these branches. May we honor you every day by living always in His Spirit, for He is the Lord, forever and ever.
God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Disciples then went off
entered the city, and found it just as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is calling with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the ditch. For the Son of Man indeed goes, as it was written of him, 'But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Rebellion to that man if he had never been born.'"
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them and said,
"Take and eat, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it now in the kingdom of God."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken. For it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times.
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass by him. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me. But now, not what I will, but what you will."
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleepy and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Then while they was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came over and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to him in reply,
"You come out against a robber, swords, clubs, seizing. Day after day, I was with you, teaching in the temple, yet you did not arrest me. But that scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging, again, Pilate questioned him.
Have you no answer?
crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the King of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with, kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They addressed him to serve as a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified 2 revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Ah, you would destroy the temple in the middle of 3 days. Save yourself by coming down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion, who stood facing him, saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of the younger James, and of Joseph and Salome. These women followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having bought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled the stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, watched where he was laid.
One hour of gospel story.
was the heart of the Virgin Mary.
That all disciples of Christ may work for the good of all people and shout Hosanna with our lives. We pray to the Lord. That the leaders of our nation, entrusted with the well-being of all citizens, may lead with wisdom and good counsel. We pray to the Lord. That those who seek justice may find it in the transformation of hearts and minds and our institutions. We pray to the Lord. That all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit will experience God's love through the joy of friends, family, and healing. We pray to the Lord. That all who have died may be received into the light of Christ, who intimately knows our pain, suffering, and death. We pray to the Lord.
We remember our sickles in need of our prayers. There are many, I mentioned two very often. And John Roland had cancer. Others like him know in their hearts. And so, Lord, as we have people of faith enter into this most holy week, remembering the mysteries of our faith, Christ's journey, his journey of death to life. May we hold on to live that in our own lives as we walk to Jesus Christ, who is our Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So this will be hopefully for the indefinite future. Last time I did the announcements right after the prayer of the faithful. Starting Easter, as we slowly work our way back, returning liturgy as we knew it before these COVID times. A big step will be next week with Easter beginning and kind of returning to Mass more or less like we did before COVID hit, more than a year ago. If you can remember how that was, we're going to do that. And just cup of ascended, he took the chalice, and once more giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Lord, remember your church, spread throughout the world, bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Holy Father, the Bernard, the Bishop, Andrew, the associate, all your people. Lord, remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Have mercy on all who die and bring them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us, together with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, the Blessed Apostle, all the saints who please you throughout the ages. We merit co-heirs to eternal life and praise and glorify them through Jesus Christ, through him, and with him, and in him, in unity with the Holy Spirit. With all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Help and mercy.
You are present in the gift of your body and blood, which we celebrate in you.